सम्प्रेषण हो, समाचार होइन।
यस श्रृङ्खलाका प्रायोजक लामा एकाउन्टिङ, ज्याक्सन हाइट, न्युयोर्क,
मालिङ्गो रेस्टुरेन्ट एन्ड बार, सनिसाइड, न्युयोर्क,
होम मेड फलाफल रेस्टुरेन्ट, अस्टोरिया, न्युयोर्क,
हिमालयन एकाउन्टिङ ग्रुप एलएलसी, ज्याक्सन हाइट, न्युयोर्क,
शेर्पा कुरियर एक्सप्रेस एन्ड शेर्पा मुभर्स, ज्याक्सन हाइट्स, न्युयोर्क,
ल अफिस अफ केशवराज सिराई, मेनहारन, न्युयोर्क।
नमस्कार, स्वागत तथा अभिवादन। म शैलेश श्रेष्ठ सम्प्रेषणको यो अर्को श्रृङ्खलामा तपाईँ आदरणीय दर्शक महानुभावहरू समक्ष उपस्थित भएको छु। सधैँ झैँ तपाईँहरूको न्यानो आत्मीय माया हामीले निरन्तर पाइरहेका छौँ कार्यक्रम सम्प्रेषण र व्हाइट हिमालका लागि, र यसै गरी निरन्तर तपाईँहरूको आफ्ना सुझाव सल्लाहहरू पठाउनलाई म कार्यक्रमको प्रारम्भमै हाम्रो इमेल एड्रेस भनिहाल्छु, sampreshan@whitehimal.tv। हजुर, सधैँ जस्तो यसमा तपाईँका गहकिला सुझाव अनि सल्लाहहरू अनि मनमा लागेका कुराहरू निरन्तर लेखी पठाउनुहोला, भनी पठाउनुहोला या फोन गरी पठाउनुहोला। त्यसो भयो भने हामी सम्प्रेषणलाई हामीले बाचा गरे जस्तै हामी सबै तपाईँहरूको कार्यक्रम बनाउनेछौँ, निरन्तर प्रयत्न गरिरहेका छौँ। यो श्रृङ्खलामा हुन त सधैँ नै म एक्साइटमेन्टको कुरा गर्छु, पुलकित भएको कुरा गर्छु, विशेषको कुरा पनि निरन्तर गर्छु सम्प्रेषणमा। यसचोटि फेरि हामीलाई यो न्युयोर्क राज्यको यो सहरमा बस्दा अर्को एउटा राम्रो अवसर जुरेको छ, जुराइदिएको छ आइसिआईले न्यू स्कुलको इन्डिया चाइना इन्स्टिच्युटमा एउटा विराट फोरम भइरहेको जानकारी हामीलाई प्राप्त भयो। त्यसमा एउटा यस्तो व्यक्तित्व पनि समावेश हुनुहुँदैछ भन्ने सुनेपछि हामीले हर तरहले उहाँलाई यो सम्प्रेषण मार्फत, यो कार्यक्रम मार्फत प्रस्तुत गर्ने हामीले निर्णय गरेर हामी निरन्तर लागिरह्यौँ, र त्यो हाम्रो यत्न सफल पनि भयो र उहाँसँग वार्ताको निम्ति हामीले तिथिमिति तय गऱ्यौँ। केही क्षणमा हामी तपाईँ दर्शक महानुभावहरूलाई त्यहाँसम्म लान्छौँ। उहाँ को हुनुहुन्छ भन्ने जिज्ञासा होला यति भनिसकेपछि, र विशेष गरी नेपालका राजनैतिक वृत्तमा जहिले जहिले पनि हामी मित्र राष्ट्र भारततर्फको परनिर्भरता जहिले पनि देखाउँछौँ, जे हुँदा पनि भारतीयहरूको चाहिँ भारतले यसो गर्यो उसो गर्यो भनेर भन्छौँ जसो गर्दा पनि हामी, हजुर त्यो वृत्तमा विशेष गरेर भारत भनेर जान्दाखेरि साउथ ब्लकका नामले जहिले पनि जानिन्छ, बुझिन्छ। र एकजना व्यक्तित्व हामीले यसपालि फेला पऱ्यौँ र उहाँसँग वार्ता गर्न जाँदैछौँ, जसलाई परोक्ष रूपमा, अघोषित रूपमा साउथ ब्लकलाई उहाँले चलाउनुहुन्छ, नचाउनुहुन्छ या खेलाउनुहुन्छ भनेर भन्छन्। त्यसो गर्दा नेपालका थुप्रै राजनेताहरूसँग निरन्तर सम्बन्ध विकास गरिरहनु भएका एउटा व्यक्तित्व, हामीले यो विशेष गरी आइसिआईको फोरममा मैले उहाँसँग अत्यन्त आत्मीय वार्ता गर्ने पनि अवसरहरू पाएँ यसपालि, र आत्मीयताका साथ उहाँले बारम्बार भनिरहनु भयो कि एकजना नेपालका असल शुभचिन्तक छु भनेर, शुभेच्छुक हुँ भनेर उहाँले बारम्बार हामीलाई भनिरहनु भयो। र दुई तिन दिन फोरममा बसेपछि मलाई पनि एउटा के विश्वास लाग्यो भने, निश्चय पनि उहाँको एउटा चाहना, उहाँको सदिच्छा र उत्कण्ठा प्रारम्भदेखि मैले के पाएँ भने, नेपाल एउटा रिपब्लिक स्टेट हुनुपर्छ भन्ने उहाँको 1950 र त्यस पछाडिको प्रत्येकचोटिको चरणबद्ध आन्दोलनमा उहाँले भन्नुभएका कुरा हामीलाई खुलेर उहाँहरूले बताउनु भयो आत्मीयताका साथ। हजुर, यति भूमिकाले सायद यहाँले बुझिसक्नुभयो होला। हजुर, प्राध्यापक एसडी मुनी, यसपालिको सम्प्रेषणमा हामी वार्ता गर्न जाँदैछौँ उहाँसँग अहिले, र यो भेटकै क्रममा आत्मीयता पस्किने क्रममा मैले उहाँलाई आत्मीयतापूर्वक अलि बलमिच्याइले यसपालिको वार्तामा मुनि सर भनेर सम्बोधन गरेको छु। हजुर, अब हामी त्यही स्थलमा हामी जान्छौँ आइसिआई फोरममा, र उहाँसँग वार्तालापको निम्ति तपाईँहरूलाई हामी लाँदैछौँ, र अब हेर्नुहुन्छ तपाईँहरूले मुनि सरसँग गरिएको यो आत्मीय र अन्तरङ्ग वार्ता।
यो सम्प्रेषण हो, समाचार होइन।
वेलकम टु यु, यु हैव सो मेनी ideas as well, huge name, very influential personality. As we all know you, Professor S.D. Muni, Dr. Muni, there are so many names, but I have chosen this time Muni sir. Is that okay?
Ramrucha.
Ramrucha, thank you so much. Just to feel comfortable and be intimate with me, that is my main reason to choose the specific word. There's a lot of things to talk with you specifically about the Nepal's contemporary issues, but when we go back to previous days, your influence to Nepal. As I have started knowing you and observing and reading so many articles since 1986, particularly I know you as a huge supporter and a well-wisher of Nepal, specifically a democratic Nepal and a moreover, I would say, republic setup of Nepal. Are you agree with that point?
Yes, yes, I have always committed myself to a republic of Nepal because I was convinced that Nepal cannot develop without being a republic. The monarchy, which has been in power for more than 250 years, did not do good to Nepal. Even the Ranas, which were part of a monarchy in a way, system, did not do good to Nepal. And there's so much of potential, so much of human dynamism in Nepal, which cannot transform into a progressive Nepal unless there is a republican system.
Well, that means in the present situation, whatever going on, you are very happy because of the initially we are in that phase.
I'm very happy that you are transforming to republicanism.
Wow.
I'm not very happy because the republicanism has still to stabilize.
Yeah,
it has not been structured. There is a massive move from monarchy to republicanism, but institutions which sustain republic governance are still not in place.
Yeah, we are experiencing that kind of difficulties in Nepal, power sharing thing, and they are not honest toward the people. We are witnessing that, even though we are in the right track. But when we are talking about this point, we have to go to Jan Andolan too. India's very supportive role, and your ideas and facilitation all the time, all party, including Maoist, they have clearly, keenly said that you are so supportive for that. But one agenda always comes to the kind of confusing point, the Jana Andolan too. What were their agenda? Was the clear agenda to abolish monarchy, or just we got by chance or fluke chance having this kind of scenario?
Look, the Jan Andolan was like Prabhu Murad Dekhit in Taisi Jaki Rahi Bhavna Jaisi. Different people looked at Jan Andolan from different perspectives.
Right.
The general people's aspirations were to liberate themselves from the oppression and underdevelopment under monarchy. The Maoists Maoists had an image of a total revolution, which obviously they could not carry out through people's war, and they realized that people's war would not succeed them to take to a stage where they wanted to go. Therefore, they agreed to collaborate with the seven political parties. The seven political parties were feeling oppressed under the king's direct rule.
Yes.
Not otherwise. You see, until 2002, when the king dissolved the parliament, they were working very happily with monarchy, in one way or the other. And I don't know if they had an agenda of social political transformation as much as the Nepali Maoists had. So there were different perspectives on it. And when you have different perspectives, people coming together, they make compromises,
right,
in order to proceed further. And they decide which one is the immediate priority, which one is later priority. And the immediate priority became transformation of the political system, meaning thereby at least get rid of monarchy.
Monarchy. But in the present, the question has been raised saying that, and blaming to the party leader specifically, even for the Nepali Congress and the UML, even Maoist, that was not the main agenda to completely abolish the monarchy.
There was confusion. There were people who wanted to abolish monarchy completely.
Right.
There were people who were willing to live with a monarchy which did not have real power. So if you go to 12-point program,
right,
they talked about autocratic monarchy is not acceptable to us.
Yeah, specifically, and they were saying only for the Gyanendra who took the power. Not,
well, they did not mention Gyanendra by name, but they said autocratic monarchy is not acceptable to us. And at the same time, they said, we want total democracy. So these two words were very, very important. That the way monarchy has turned authoritarian was not acceptable to them. under Gyanendra or under Birendra, even you remember
right.
the Jan Andolan first
one
was
right.
to change Birendra's panchayat system or Mahindra's panchayat system. So the consensus existed that we don't want a monarchy which dictates to us.
Mm-hmm.
Monarchy as an institution, as a like the monarchy in Britain or some of the other European countries, or monarchy which is just sitting as a symbolic institution, they did not finally decide that. But something which was very clear was that we don't want the way this monarchy is governing us.
I don't want to go in details about that, but very specifically the question has been read. That's why I wanted to have a little clarification as you are witnessing this issue. And again, they were agreed somehow to keep on going a kind of symbolic monarchy, even baby king concept, see the situation.
Yes, that's true.
Right?
Even some of the Maoists, Baburam talked about it, we can have a baby. No, no, not Baburam. Baburam talked about a cultural monarchy.
Yes.
There were some people like Girja Babu said, we can consider baby monarchy. But they had not come to the final conclusion that we have to retain monarchy
right.
or that we must, I mean, Maoists, for instance, a very large section of the Maoists had come to this firm conclusion that we will not live with monarchy. I will take you back to the negotiations which took place between the Maoists and the king himself in 2002
okay.
With the mediation of what was his Prince Dhirendra
or Dhirendra, right.
You know, and even at that time, the Maoists were saying to the king that we will make you the first president.
Wow.
But monarchy as an institution, because there were two things very clear in the Maoist agenda. One, a constituent assembly to draft a constitution. From the beginning, very mm-hmm. consistently. And if that constituent assembly elected by the people say that we can have a cultural monarchy, it's all
right.
Right. But idea was a constitutional monarchy, and Prachanda is on public record to say that we told the king that we want you to become the first president, but you cannot continue as you are continuing.
It's a very scary side to the connection from that day to this present. Again, the scenario is very unclear.
Yeah.
Appointment of this new chairman for this thing, you know, Mr. Regmi, and some kind of surrendering all the power to the judiciary system, and a kind of controversy between this branches. And is there any possibility to revive again?
Will be like this.
Okay.
That they have accepted a government to be led by the Chief Justice.
Okay.
Because they could not come to a political conclusion or a consensus to have a political government.
Yes.
Now, even after making the Kaki government, mm-hmm. they have set up this high power political mechanism in which all the political parties' representatives are there, and they are turning the convenership by rotation.
Right.
You know, earlier Prashant was the first convener of that. Now Sushil is the convener of that. Meaning thereby that they would try to control Mr. Regmi's government through this political mechanism. Therefore, the idea was not to surrender everything to the third. Let's be very clear.
Okay.
In effect, it may become. You know, we don't know.
We don't know yet.
But this was not the idea. This criticism that you have given us a government which is non-political. Yes, you have given us a government which is non-political because Nepali Congress and Maoists were not coming to any agreement as to what kind of a political government should be there.
Right.
Therefore, the Maoists would not want the government to be led by Nepali Congress for the elections, because the Nepali Congress did not give them the constitution which they wanted. And Nepali Congress would not want the government to be led by Maoists during the elections, because the Maoists were had promised. So it was this conflict, and as a way out to this Nikas was that, all right, let us have a third party government. And in South Asia today, in Bangladesh,
right.
in Pakistan, now in Nepal, right. you have the caretaking governments who are mandated only to conduct elections.
Yeah.
By non-political
We have
entities.
Seen that in the last...
By non-political yeah. activities.
In Bangladesh also it's been
practiced. Yes, yes. No, in Bangladesh it has happened, it is now again they are demanding. The same thing.
Yeah, I respect
that. That Hazira should not be there and there should be...
But the civic society clearly and loudly asking why they present super, you know, justice. Now, why not the former one? That was the question. And he's going to come back
in position. I can't go into that. It is a question of mutual agreement. If they agreed on certain person, they agreed on certain person.
So you believe election should be there at any cost?
Well, I believe that without election, Nepal would not be able to even inch forward.
Wow. Intra-relationship, like in the very present days, and your advocacy and your supports, clearly seen very supportive road to Maoist movement till the republic set up. And the South Bloc has seen the ideas and their support, it's been said in the many medias in Nepal. And traditionally, the Indian South Bloc were so close to the Nepali Congress Party and suddenly shifted toward the CPN Maoist. Is that the clear scenario? Just media
fair enough.
Sensational.
Media, but let us be very clear, I am not South Bloc to begin with.
I didn't mean that.
You did not mean, but media
always.
Number one, let me make things clear.
Okay.
I'm not South Bloc. I don't speak on behalf of South Bloc. I have severely criticized on times South Bloc's Nepal policy. But at the same time, India has played a role which is something which cannot be avoided.
Right.
In fact, more than me, the political parties seek the intervention of the South Bloc.
Yes, we have clearly seen
that is one thing. Now, what South Bloc wants, only somebody from South Bloc can tell you very clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But as I read their mind, what I read is that they are for elections, they are for democracy. Now, it is not that they were in favor of Nepali Congress and they shifted to the Maoists. They shifted to the Maoists to streamline them in a coalition which was headed by the SPA.
Okay.
12.12. The new Delhi system never wanted the coalition to be headed by the Maoists when 12 points were being drawn. Let us be very clear. And I know for sure that New Delhi took a hell lot of time even in accepting to this proposition that Maoists should be brought into the mainstream.
Right.
I mean, I have told in some meetings, I have written about it, that Indian Prime Minister talked to King Gyanendra on three occasions, one-to-one.
Wow.
And on all the three occasions, he pleaded with him that you join hands with the political parties and isolate the Maoists.
Okay.
But the King would not accept that.
Right.
And King was very sure that he can take both the Maoists and the political parties on the same platform. So that did not succeed. And New Delhi, and not only New Delhi, I would say the entire international community, the US, the European Union, they all found that King was so obstinate. So there was no other option but to accept the coalition of the Maoist in Jan Andolan with the SPA and move forward. And they moved forward. And when Maoists were elected, India was shocked.
Right.
In 2000 elections.
Correct.
They were not happy with the Maoist dominance. They are not happy with Maoist dominance even later on. You remember the kind of when Prachanda resigned on the Katwal issue. And then almost for 2-3 years, Madhav Nepal's government. Now, Madhav Nepal was not even elected popular.
No, absolutely not.
So, you know,
every incident, any consequences, it has been blamed to India and the so-called South Bloc. Actually, what is the South Bloc? It is very traditional format. Is there any new revision and a definition of South Bloc? You have mentioned many occasions, very friendly, very intimate way, the relation between India and Nepal, Beti and the Roti relation. Is there any new dynamics you can see?
See, India,
wider range.
India is a very big country, number one.
Absolutely.
Number two, the Indian politicians and the decision makers do not devote as much of time on Nepal as the Nepali media thinks they devote.
Yes.
They have different priorities. Their priorities are China, their priorities are Pakistan, their priorities are America.
It's global.
And in various other ways. There are very few people who are really knowledgeable in India about what's happening on Nepal.
Right.
And in that knowledge, many times their view is distorted because many of the Nepalese leaders.
Correct.
Go to New Delhi and tell them. And whatever these people, it may be Mr. Oli, it may be Sushil Koirala, it may be Shekhar Koirala, it may be Jalnath Khanal, or if Jalnath Khanal has gone very little, but Madhav Nepal or lot of Tarai leaders, so many people keep going and coming to India. And they meet the leaders, tell them their stories, this is what is happening. The leadership in India is influenced by them. Because they don't have any direct access to what is happening in Nepal. They hear these stories all the time. If you look at Indian media, they devote so little time on any space on Nepal. Therefore, I have said in Kathmandu that India's Nepal policy to some extent is an uninformed policy. Many times. And because of being uninformed policy, they commit mistakes. There's no doubt about it. And when they commit mistake, they try to rectify it later. For instance, earlier they isolated Maoists. Now they are willing to accept Maoists. Because they found that isolating Maoists did not serve any purpose. So it's learning from your own mistakes many times.
Correct.
It happens. Which I'm afraid nobody in Nepal, well I would not say nobody, but hardly anyone is very seriously and objectively concentrating on how Indian decision making takes place on Nepal and what are the real issues involved.
I think those kind of, this is not an invitation, whoever goes there for the treatment, Mr. Oli, or from that day from Surya Bahadur Thapa, the recent visit of Prachand Pushpakamal Dahal.
Even King, I mean King went so many times.
Yeah, absolutely.
He sent so many messengers there to do this, do
he
not, to do that.
Many occasions and the religious purpose.
That's the roti beti sambandh.
There
is a roti beti sambandh between the king and the Indians.
Right.
And there is a roti beti sambandh between an ordinary Tarai man and many of the Indians, or ordinary Pahar men and many Indians.
No doubt, we have very close relation culturally, religiously, that kind. But always the political party and their leaders from that day till now, it's a playing anti-Indian sentiment kind of thing.
They are anti-Indian.
Even in mainstream media.
No, they are anti-Indian when they are not in power.
Okay.
I can tell you all kind of stories, because anybody who is not in power thinks that he is not in power because India doesn't want it.
Okay.
Which is totally wrong. I mean, there are so many other situations.
The blame game is recently, that kind of things coming up. From Khilraj Regmi to the recent thing, Lokman Singh Kharki issues, it's a grand design by South Bloc. Again, and the same thing goes on, and they're blaming each other. And blasted in the mainstream media.
This is utterly irrational, that's all I can say. And it is not based on assessment of facts.
But Muni sir, this interpretation, this Sampreshan, sometimes receive few related letters from my regular view. I have recently received very concerning issues about your conversation with me. Can I read it?
Please.
All right. It's very... from my one very regular viewer, his name is Mr. Anjan Shrestha. It's for you. You have said repeatedly that India is very concerned with Nepali politics because of security and economic interest. India would be more secure if there would be peace in Nepal, isn't it? If you feel so, why there is constant activities from Indian side to make Nepal more unstable? Is Indian national being arrested with Forbes, Nepali currency and arms inside, Nepali people are getting killed by Indian agents. When Nepal is more unstable, other enemy of India, as you said, will also take advantage of Nepali situation to work against India, which will be definitely unfavorable for Indian security interest. Instead, that kind of security and instability eventually going to affect India, that's the kind of question. How do you define?
Your viewer mixes it up with fake currency and criminal activity. Now, to deal with criminal activity and fake currency is the responsibility of almost every government.
Correct.
Whether it is New Delhi or whether even in Kathmandu.
Right.
If you have people who are dealing in currency exchanges or which are not correct, that's not... political instability. Political instability is contributed mostly by the political actions of the people in Nepal.
Mm-hmm.
And to blame it entirely on India is, as I said, it is unjustified, highly exaggerated. Because there are several examples.
Right.
For instance, I mean, if India is so influential, now let me put this to your viewer.
Okay.
That if he thinks India is so influential, and India does everything, every instability, right, why it is that till today India could not succeed on two of its major objectives? One objective was hydropower harnessing.
Right.
The second objective was ensuring security.
Mm-hmm.
If India could decide everything in Kathmandu, why would an Indian plane be hijacked from Kathmandu? I see no reason. I mean,
absolutely,
these people are emotionally charged. Everything which they find, they cannot find a solution, mm-hmm, they put it on India. I want to know from him, if India is so influential,
right,
why it is that we could not get two simple things out of a friendly neighbor, which is in the interest of both of us.
Yeah.
The security of India and security of Nepal is in the interest of both India and Nepal. And harnessing of hydropower will be in the interest of Nepal as well as in the interest of India. Why it is that these two simple objectives we could not? Why it is that fake currency comes many times,
right,
through, yeah, Nepal, mm-hmm, into India? And if India could stop it, why it is not stopping it?
Another viewer's right here. If Nepal's situation would be more worse than now, and it will be very unstable in the future, do you really think India will invade Nepal by military to protect its security interest? Just question from my regular.
This is what I'm saying. You know, these are so imbalanced and so emotional and so distorted questions that they just want to indulge into what you said earlier, a blame game.
Yeah.
That anything which happens, you are responsible for it. I mean, it means that you are not being able to keep your house in order.
So we are not responsible.
Yes, of
That's
course.
Right.
I mean, which means if for everything an outsider is responsible, then there is something wrong with the people who are living in the house.
Right. I was very lucky to have a few conversation informally with you, and once you have mentioned about the China policy, China is not happy with the recent situation in Nepal, specifically the federalism in Nepal, specifically its borderline close to Tibet areas. How do you define that?
Hazur, yehi thiyo aile bharkar Muni sir sanga hamile ICI ko sabakakshama हामीले एउटा आत्मीय वार्तालाप गरेर फर्क्यौँ. जसरी जिद्दी गरेर बलमिच्याई गरेर आफ्नो ठानेर मैले सम्मानित एउटा व्यक्तित्वलाई मुनि सर भनेर उहाँको परमिसनमा सम्बोधन गरेँ, हो त्यस्तै आत्मीय वार्तालाप भयो भन्ने लाग्यो हामीलाई पनि. र तपाईँहरूलाई सम्प्रेषणको यो सेगमेन्टमा, यो श्रृङ्खलामा त्यही कुरा पस्किरहेका छौँ. एउटा यस्तो विराट व्यक्तित्व जो भारतीय सरकारको 36 वर्षीय सेवाकाल पुरा गरी उहाँ निवृत्त हुनुभएको छ. विशेष गरेर उपल्लो हुँदामा कूटनीति कामहरू निरन्तर गरिरहनु भयो, र नेपालका बारेमा सबभन्दा बढी जानिने मान्छे र नयाँ दिल्लीलाई, विशेष गरी साउथ ब्लकलाई सबभन्दा बढी इन्फ्लुएन्स गर्न सक्ने व्यक्तिका रूपमा जहिले पनि एसटी मुनिलाई लिइन्छ. बाँकी भाग चाहिँ अर्को श्रृङ्खलामा, सम्प्रेषणको अर्को भागमा मुनि सरको वार्तालाप प्रस्तुत गर्ने बाचा गर्दै अहिलेको यो सेगमेन्ट र मुनि सरसँग भएको आत्मीय वार्तालापको पहिलो श्रृङ्खलाबाट चाहिँ हामीलाई अहिले बिदा दिनुहोला. म यही अनुमति चाहन्छु, यो श्रृङ्खलाबाट चाहिँ म बिदा चाहन्छु. हवस् त, नमस्कार अनि जय नेपाल.
यो सम्प्रेषण हो, समाचार होइन.
यस श्रृङ्खलाका प्रायोजक Lama Accounting, Jackson Heights, New York.
Malingo Restaurant and Bar, Sunnyside, New York.
Homemade Falafel Restaurant, Astoria, New York.
Himalayan Accounting Group, LLC, Jackson Heights, New York.
Sherpa Courier Express and Sherpa Movers, Jackson Heights, New York.
Law Office of Kesavraj Sidai, Manhattan, New York.